I think you have to turn on your microphone. I cannot hear you.
I'm sorry.
Yes, now.
Right.
Now I
Yeah.
can.
Sorry.
Good.
All right.
Right.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Hello, hello. Good afternoon and evening, Indonesia. Good morning, Germany. Good day for our friends from all the rest of the world. It must be evening and night in Pacific, Australia, and New Zealand, afternoon and evening in Asia, morning now in Europe and Africa, early morning in North America, Central America, and South America. First and foremost, thank you everyone for coming. Welcome to this international webinar that is attended by participants from 71 countries of 6 continents around the globe, hopefully. We are gathering this day, all nations, citizens of the world, to be united for helping the people against blindness. Welcome to our 24th episode of Distinguished Maestro Lecture. I am Gede Pardianto from Indonesia. Let's start the webinar. To honor the origin country of this webinar, please pay attention to Indonesian national anthem. Thank you so much. Now, to honor the origin country of our distinguished speaker, please pay attention to German national anthem. Thank you. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, the great maestro this time will be Dr. Detlef Breyer, a master, a friend of mine, multiple award winner, the pioneer, and a world-class cornea specialist. Dr. Breyer was among the first in the world to introduce and implement the FDA-approved Relax Smile laser technology. He was one of the developers of the micro-incision cataract surgery. And he was also among the very first to implement the minimal invasive laser technology. Dr. Breyer is the founder of Breyer, Kemak, and Klabe Augen Surgery in Dusseldorf, Germany. He is a co-founder of the Research Institute for International Innovative Ophthalmic Surgery in Dusseldorf. Dr. Breyer is also a co-founder of International Vision Correction Research Center Network of Universitat Augenklinik Heidelberg, Germany. And Dr. Breyer was accepted into the elite circle of American European ophthalmic surgeon. Dr. Breyer has been the chair and keynote speaker at so many international conferences. He served on the editorial board of several scientific journals. Dr. Breyer has authored and co-authored more than 100 scientific papers and presentations. Dr. Breyer also has performed over 40,000 surgeries, and he has been consistently been nominated as the best in class surgeon in his field. And now he is going to deliver the maestro lecture to hundreds of participants from more than 71 countries of 6 continents around the world. Wow, that is incredible. At this very moment, he will present a very important topic with the title Small Incision Lenticule Extraction. It will be a really fascinating topic. Now, we are learning from the man who is a grand maestro on this field. So be prepared. Fellow ophthalmologists, let's pay attention to Professor Detlef Breyer. So Detlef, we are counting down for you. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Time is all yours. Lift off. Applause. Godspeed, Detlef Breyer.
Hey, so hello, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be with you this morning or evening in Indonesia. And it was also a great pleasure to hear your national anthem. I never heard it before, but it's very nice, I have to say. Very positive and enchanting. I really liked it. So the introduction was very honorable. So thanks for this. I'm now going to present my presentation about SMILE and how to smile even more. It's a little coming from the history to nowadays smile surgery. As I started 13 years ago, I had the honor and pleasure to pioneer this technique as one of the first 5 surgeons in the world. So once upon a time, that was really 13 years ago, it was a radical cut for us. We were one of the first 10 laser clinics worldwide to use the then not even FDA approved technique. It was just CE certified then. But from day one, we really stopped doing femtosecond LASIK in myopic patients. We completely switched to SMILE. But finding the perfect laser energy settings was the toughest part. And of course, was a complication management as well, because it was very tricky when you do not have a reference and you can't look up complication in another teaching book, but you have to find the solution by yourself. So this was our starting kit. 13 years ago, it was a MEL-80 excimer laser and the Zeiss VisuMax laser. Why did we start so early and why have I been so fascinated? Very simple, because I think surgery should always choose, especially in elective surgery, the most and easy procedure that produces the fewest complications. And we all know when we do LASIK, and I still do LASIK for presbyopia correction, it was a great pleasure. But we know when the patient gets up from the surgical bed and walks out, from that day on, you are for the next days a little bit frightened. Might he rub his eyes or move the flap? Even last weekend, I had to go back into the clinic on Saturday because the patient was rubbing the eye. The flap was in folds. Of course, it's not a big problem. You can reposition it. You put a contact lens and the patient is fine. But nevertheless, as a surgeon, you are always like, something can happen. But how about smile? You can also have, of course, complications with smile. I just want to show one complication. Here you see a really big black spot. That means an area where the laser was not working. And that means you cannot dissect in this area. And that again means end of surgery. So you have to tell the patients, sorry, we can't do anything for you. And in this special case, we never found out why was it, because this was really not a typical case. It was one case in thousands of smile surgeries. But of course, in this case, you cannot complete. I tried to, but there was no chance. So let's go ahead. That was one problem, black spots. And as I mentioned before, it was in the first years tough to find out the right energy settings. I even had full-time employed PhD physicist who was trying to find together with me the right data and energy settings. For those who are interested in this, in September 2019, I published those data and the journey to find the right energy settings. But even it was only in 2019 when we said, now we can publish it. Now we are really sure about the data settings. What else can happen in this great surgery? What we call a near suction loss. Start it again. The video should run now. It shows the bar here on my computer, but it doesn't continue. It's counting down. So sorry for that. Perhaps we just move on to the next slide. But even this I cannot do. So that means right now I would like to proceed, but I cannot because the presentation and the video stopped. Let's see. It that does not react. I can't even proceed. No. Okay, let's take the other video. It also does not proceed. Okay, so let's go back. Perhaps now. Let's see. Now it might. Okay, that's another video where it shows unhappy suction loss where you cannot continue. So you see a little black spot at 5 o'clock, but this doesn't matter. It's no problem at all. We could have continued. But of course, if this happens, there's no chance you can redock and continue surgery. That's it. So are these the only possible complications? No, there are more. Happily, they never happened to me. So the maximum was I had to cancel surgery. I never had a problem that there was a big problem with a patient who had, due to safety reasons, worse vision afterwards. But this is a book I can recommend to those who are interested in this kind of surgery. So what did we do when we had to stop surgery? Either we continued with PRK, the trans-PRK, or we implanted an ICL. And another procedure is not just implanting an ICL. As you can see here, perhaps this is interesting. I marked the axis with a lens R femtosecond laser on the cornea, because this way I do have an iris scan. And due to the iris scan, I can avoid any misalignment of the ICL that I implanted. So another possibility is turning SMILE into LASIK. This is called the circle procedure. I don't have a video as I never had to use it, but that's also interesting. Like Professor Secundo once called it, the worst complication of SMILE is LASIK. He of course meant it in a funny way, but there's also a little bit of truth in it. So in those times, we compared femtosecond LASIK to SMILE, 404 cases with femtosecond LASIK to nearly 2,200 relaxed SMILE cases. And as you can see, femtosecond LASIK in red, the relaxed SMILE in black, very much comparable, nearly the same safety. So they were very close together in that concern. And what I especially like about this chart is that we didn't have a loss of more than two lines, but even had a gain of more than two lines. We also had with both procedures a very high predictability. And this graph very much reflects the beginning of SMILE surgery, because as you can see, we do have some patients with an undercorrection. And over the time, we learned to get our own nomogram. And this nomogram helped us over the last 13 years to always furthermore improve the high predictability of this procedure. And I'm going to present later on data with the newest laser. Both procedures also had a very close high effectiveness. And we showed this in times where everybody said, RelaxSMILE can't be closely as good as femtosecond LASIK. I remember many presentations from a friend, Professor Seiler, who said, it can never be as precise and as effective. But as you can see here, it can be as effective and as precise as femtosecond LASIK surgery. We had a very low rates of complications, and you have to consider, as I mentioned before, when you're a pioneering surgeon, I'm now presenting those data from a pioneering surgeon and not of a routine procedure. In one patient, we had to do, as I mentioned before, and implant an ICL. Three of those patients a little bit lost their bravery, and they are still wearing glasses or contact lenses. And one patient was turned into a trans PRK. So the other only five complications we had in over 6,000 procedures was that we couldn't remove the lenticule. And the results, as I presented before, were slightly better than with femtosecond LASIK. But I think those are more scientific data than everyday data. When you switch to everyday experience, if you ask me, is SMILE much better than femtosecond LASIK? I would say no. They're both the same with the results. It's just the high safety level of SMILE, which I think is really convincing. The one patient where we couldn't remove the lenticule, we transferred it to a friend who did a trans PRK. I didn't do at that time trans PRK. I just bought the Schwind laser 4 years ago. But the patient today has a 20/20 visual acuity. Today, I think I would change tactics as I learned from Osama Ibrahim and Sri Ganesh from India and Egypt. I think I would try to do a lenticularexis, or I would prefer a circle procedure, as with trans PRK, you always have the problem of pain, of a slow visual recovery, and the possibility of haze or corneal scarring. But I was a little bit untrue. I hide it in this presentation 15 complications. Those are suction losses, which we had 11 after 16 seconds. But that was not a problem, because when you have in the first 60 seconds this kind, or after, excuse me, after 16 seconds, this kind of complication, you can reapply the vacuum and it turns into a happy end. But if it happens before 12 seconds, then you have to switch to trans-PRK ICL glasses or contact lenses, as mentioned before. This is okay, but of course the patient then was not really happy because he wanted to have no glasses anymore. So as you can see, there unhappy patient may be produced more or less in the first 12 seconds. So there was a need for speed. That was the only pain left for smile surgeons to reduce the fear of suction loss and also to psychologically tear down the patient's fear wall, that they go into a surgery where they could have a suction loss and this would turn into another procedure. So there was definitely need for speed, and that's why we bought this February the new VisuMax 800. Main reason, because it was it's really a fast laser, but we also enjoyed the compact design of this laser. As you can see here, the blue laser arm, you can change colors from yellow, orange, red, and the patients can choose their color. One might say this is a gimmick, but it's not really a gimmick. It's something the patients really like. For us as surgeons, we say, okay, that's a gimmick, but the patient really liked that. It empowers them. It has an excellent workflow, of course, as you can imagine. The second arm here is an OPMI microscope. You're all used to the high size quality. And as you can see, the accessibility for the patient is also very easy and easier as with the old laser. So as I showed you before, there are two arms. The one is for SmilePro flap creation and ICRS, or the circle procedure. And the other arm is the OPMI microscope. This is how it looks like, and in another perspective. And it provides really very short treatment times. You can imagine that a treatment time of only 10 seconds as a 2 megahertz laser in SMILE is really, really great. It includes a central line centration aim for beginners, especially important, not so much for the used surgeon. It has a cyclotorsion control called Oculine. It uses nomograms you can personalize, which is called Visualize, and it connects to the ZEISS refractive working place. Here you can see the data we use for Smile Pro, and this session is recorded, so I don't have to count it down, but you just can ask for the recording. Here you see the centration aid. The vertex position can be entered in the treatment planning. The pupil-centered vertex portion are indicated on the screen. So this is a good orientation, especially for those who start with SMILE. This is a central line, as you can see it here. It compares the central offset and is really, I think, a great help, especially for beginners. And of course, everybody was asking, we are used to excellent eye trackers in eczema and laser surgery. They're not as important in SMILE, but nevertheless, we asked for it, and ZEISS was delivering it now to even improve the astigmatism control and cyclotorsion adjustment. You can readjust it with the IOL master. So as I mentioned before, only 10 seconds for Smile Pro and 5 seconds for flap creation, I think, is a big step forward. In former times, we needed 30 seconds for a smile, and this really makes a big difference for the patient and for the surgeon. It's really calming down the heart rate and the blood pressure from both surgeons and patients. So here you see a direct comparison, a smile with the old laser on the left-hand side and with a new laser on the right-hand side. And you can see that the Smile Pro is much faster. Let's go back. Whenever I click on it, it disappears. So let's start perhaps here with a Smile Pro, and then you see how fast it works. Come on. Yeah, now you can see it, how fast the Smile Pro procedure is. So the event of suction loss is reduced. But as I'm saying this, I had a suction loss yesterday after 8 seconds. I couldn't believe it. I thought 10 seconds are really fast enough. But as we know, some patients are very, very nervous, and it can happen to those even in a 10-second procedure. Another advantage is with the 10 seconds of the Smile Pro, it seems as there is no time for opaque bubble layers. I never had a patient with an opaque bubble layer as I had before with a Relax Smile. So with Smile Pro, it also seems to be more precise and safe as a Relax Smile. So I turned in a very big fan of the Smile Pro procedure. Here you can see the docking on the eye, and as a help also for beginners or for those who start with this procedure, you have two cameras. And so you're not looking through a microscope anymore, but it's a real digital procedure. Now you are looking at TV screens while you dock and while you do surgery. I personally didn't think you need that, but maybe it's a good help for those who are not used to look through a surgical microscope. So this might be a step forward. So we had a look at our first cases, and I was very interested in real-world data. So we did this in the course of our quality management standard protocol. I did not control the data by intention because I want to have real-world data. And we had a closer look at safety, predictability, and efficacy 3 months after surgery, and we used ETDRS patient charts. So these are the eyes, 270 eyes we did in the first 3 months, and we controlled after 3 months. So you see the patients were not very young, but we are more or less premium. Eyes is a premium clinic. So we charged 5,900 euro, which might explain the little bit older age in clinics who are more in the low cost area. Patients surely are younger. If you look at the distribution of male and female, you clearly see that females are more brave than men. And our target cap was 150 micrometers wherever possible. Why so deep? Because the deeper you go, the more stiff and stable the cornea gets. Though this was our intention, we had a minimum stromal thickness in low myopia, if we used it only for one diopter, of around about 20 micrometers. And the target refraction, of course, was depending on the nomogram and the age. Here are the results 3 months post-operative. The most important thing is nobody lost two lines. But if you look at a graph like that, what does it mean in real life? So I asked my optometrist, please do me a favor and call those 21% who gained or lost online if they realized this. So they called up the patient and said, did you recognize that your vision is a little bit better or a little bit worse? And all of them answered, more or less, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't need glasses anymore. So this is scientific data, but the patients themselves don't really realize if they lose or gain one line. If you look at the predictability, you can see in contrast to Relax Smile in Smile Pro, we had more or less a little bit hyperopic shift. Why is it? Because we nowadays, and I was talking to my optometrist, why do we have this hyperopic shift? And she said, yes, because you intended it. And I said, ah, right, you're right, because that's what we do in younger patients. If somebody is between 30 years of age, we target for plus 0.5 and over 30 for plus 2.5. So these are really excellent first results. And this was even more surprising for us that 100% of the patients had a 20/20 vision. That was really very convincing when you use a kind of a new method or new laser that you have this success. So what was our first conclusion? That the first safety, predictability, and efficacy data were better than with a VisuMax 500 and the femtosecond LASIK outcomes in the literature, and that the only 10 seconds procedure is really a big clinical psychological advantage, not only for the patients, but also for the surgeons. So in all those 217 cases, at that time, we had no intraoperative complication, no suction loss, no black spots, no infections, no haze, no nothing. So no complication, despite, as I said yesterday, there was one patient who had a suction loss after 8 seconds. So in all those patients, we could complete our lenticular renewal. Is it as easy as LASIK surgery? No, it's still a corneal procedure. So don't underestimate the removal of the lenticule. It's still not perfect. It still depends very much on the skills of the surgeons. Did we see post-operative complications? No, we didn't. That's why overall we needed no touch-up surgery in our first 217 cases. And as you anyway know, the patients don't have pain during and after surgery. And if there's no flap, you can have no flap complications. So we think today, up to date, it's really the safest laser surgical procedure with excellent results for our myopic patients. And we are very much looking for to get the new software for hyperopic patients. I heard from Sri Ganesh from India and Walter Secundo from Marburg, who are doing this kind of work already, and then Reinstein in London, that there are excellent results and they're even better than with LASIK. So I'm looking very much for this and also for presbyopia correction, which will be in the laser software in 1 year from now. As I mentioned before, there is one clinical pearl. As you can see here, this is what we show to the patients, that they can choose their color during surgery. And of course, we as surgeons or scientists, we say, okay, this is a real argument. And I just recognized this art behind me is very close to those colors. I'm sitting in my dining room and this is a piece of art behind me. And as you can see, the colors are very similar, but this really happened by chance. I just recognized it right now. But this little fact really empowers patients and makes them feel more easy. Then again, I try to show another video and it works nicely. If you have a look at this, especially at the pupil area, you might recognize some opaque plaques when we get closer. And those are not is not by Bowman gland secretions, as you can see when we move the patient interface on the patient's eye, it doesn't move. it's just there, and I had it in other cases. We had much more reflections or opaque plaques, but as you can see, they do not interfere with laser surgery. So we have to differentiate those from other plaques, for example, from meibomian gland secretions that cause black spots. Another clinical pearl I used in two patients right now, as they came close to residual stromal thickness of 250 micrometers, the Smile Extra, first published by Sri Ganesh and Sheetal Brar from India. So this is a picture of this patient's but as we have only 3 months experience, of course, we all know late keratasia. It's called late keratasia because it comes after months or years. So we have this kind of surgery only 3 months ago. So I cannot present any long-term results. And I think that's a clinical pearl as well. It is important for smile surgery to use the right instrument. I sometimes see people using a spoon-like instrument, which first of all looks safer, but the dissection of the lenticule is easier with this instrument. As you can see, it has on the one end, like a dolphin nose. The first concept was done by Professor Pfeffel, and I refined it a little bit for smile surgery with this dolphin-like nose. So if you do have any questions, please don't hesitate to ask me, and you can even reach me on Facebook or Instagram. If you have any more questions, you can write or send me a message, and I'm more than happy to tell you about this wonderful procedure. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you so much. What a lecture, Professor Breyer. Exceptional presentation. I think that was super impressive.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Beloved ophthalmologists, now we are approaching the question and answer session. So that left, maybe I will read its question for you. There are four questions. The first question will be, dear professor, do you have any experience with corneal tear during smile surgery and how to prevent and to cure that situation? Thank you so much, professor.
I was very lucky. I never had it, but I saw one or two videos, and I think that's a very good approach. When you have a corneal tear, that you just superimpose a contact lens. You carefully continue surgery, you finish surgery, and after surgery, you just put a contact lens on it. Like if you do have any flap complications, that's what you are doing, and I think that's a reasonable and good approach.
All right. Thank you so much, Professor. The next question from Dr. Morteza Mortazavi Fard. Dr. Morteza Mortazavi Fard is from Iran. What are your hints for decreasing suction loss? Thank you so much, Professor.
This is the most important thing is how you talk to the patients. It's mainly a psychological problem. And it's funny, I don't know if you also have, I have patients from all over the world. And when you go from north, like Scandinavia or Russians, they're under the laser, they don't move an inch, not a millimeter. They're very cool. If you go to the Mediterranean, they are a little bit more excited. If you go to the Arab countries, they're very much excited. So, and there you tendentially have more suction losses. So what are you doing? It's very important when the patient enters your practice or your clinic that somebody takes care of them, that all is done in a quiet environment, that everybody of your employees is very polite, that they introduce themselves. Then when the patient comes in, when I see them, the first thing I say, You choose a very great procedure. Calm down, relax. Nothing will happen to you. This is a smile surgery. In smile surgery, nothing can happen to you. So calming down the patient is number one. Second is a good management of the suction during surgery. That means always talking to the patient, that he does not lose trust. When you don't talk to patients and something happens, like the green blinking light disappears or the vision is getting worse, then patients get nervous and they think they have to do something. So talking during surgery is very important. And another point is the so-called fluid management, that the eyes are not dry, number one, but not too wet. But this, of course, I personally don't use, many use a lid speculum with vacuum. I don't use a lid speculum with vacuum. I just rinse with ice cold water the cornea with 10 milliliters. And then I use just cotton swabs to remove the, bless you, the water that is too much. So I think the fluid management really is important.
Thank you so much, Professor. The third question will be, Professor, would you like to explain more about hyperopic shift in high astigmatism? Thank you soon, Professor.
Yeah, it is, I would say I don't really have a nomogram. It is more or less experience. I think Dan Reinstein did a very nice publication about his experiences, so perhaps you might look it up. But it's true, you have a very small hyperopic shift in high astigmatism. So my thumb rule is up to 3 diopters, it's 2.5, 0.5, and over 3 diopters, it's 0.5. 0.75. So this is my thumb rule.
Thank you so much. The next question, dear professor, during your experience, how is the best management to treat high astigmatism satisfied? Thank you.
I go up, the highest astigmatisms I treated were up to 5.5 diopters. And in those times where we did not have a cyclotorsion control, I was closely looking at the iris structure, if there is a cyclotorsion. And if I detected the cyclotorsion, I redocked. I didn't continue. I redocked. I talked to the patient, tried to calm him down. There is also a very interesting alternative if you want to control the cyclotorsion. There, just look up a YouTube video from Sri Ganesh where he marks the cornea. This might be helpful too.
All right. We back to Dr. Morteza Mortazafifar from Iran. How do you differentiate anterior from posterior plane of dissection? Thank you.
As you saw the instrument before, there are 2 sides. The first side is the one you know from LASIK surgery. The other one is a little bit like a Sinsky hook. So I take this, enter the incision, and then I turn the tip of the hook towards the ceiling of the cap. So while I point toward the cap, I identify the upper plane so that I'm not preparing the lower plane. Because when you prepare the lower plane first, it can be a little bit tricky, especially if you don't have the instrument I showed you before. When you have a spoon-like instrument, it's really tough to then continue surgery. So it all starts with the right technique in the beginning. Take the hook, enter the incision, turn it to the ceiling or the top of the lenticule or the cap, and then you are in the right plane.
Thank you so much, Professor. The next question from Dr. Morteza Mortazafifar from Iran. will be what are the advantages of new version of the Sumac machine? Thank you.
There are three. The number one is speed. So there really was a need for speed. It had to become faster, and everybody who did this kind of surgery said, we need a faster machine, number one, to reduce complication rates. Number two, cyclotorsion control is not so important for an experienced surgeon, but it still was a little bit of art. Now having a cyclotorsion control is turning art into science. So I think this is an advantage. And also the oculine is very interesting. That means the centration is easier with the oculine system. And last but not least, the visualized nomogram, it's again turning art into science, because you will know from your own laser the nomogram. Because as we all know, if you're in a hot climate or if you're in a cold climate, if you have very dry air in your OR or whatever, or how stiff the cornea is, then you have your own population of patients. So individualized nomogram is a big advantage.
Thank you so much, Professor. The next question, excuse me, Professor, do you agree or recommend the SMILE to a candidate for the military academy students? Thank you in advance, Professor.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. Why is it? Because, you know, as I said before, with a flap, you always have this, we call it the sword of Damocles, that this web, the flap might dislocate, especially in military people or people in fighting sports. So if somebody comes to me and is in fighting sports, I say, I don't think it's a good idea to a LASIK procedure. I would very much prefer a SMILE procedure. But it is FDA approved for the military. But if you ask me for my personal belief, what would you do in your family? In this case, I would prefer SMILE. And if I would be an advisor to the military, I would also prefer SMILE. No question.
Thank you so much, Professor. The next question from Dr. Mortazavi. Do you have any case of DLK, diffuse lamellar keratitis, after SMILE procedure?
No. And I'm very happy about that. At the beginning, when we didn't have the perfect laser settings, of course, the more traumatic surgery is, the more you see kind of a haze the next day. But it all disappeared with steroid eye drops. Today, with a very fast laser, with this perfect bubble pattern, without opaque bubble, I don't even see those haze-like conditions in the first day. They are crystal clear the first day. So it was clearly depending on the energy settings and of the way of preparation of the lenticule.
Thank you so much, Professor. The next question from Iran. Will you please compare the risks of ectasia between SMILE and LASIK? Thank you so much.
I have to confess, I do have one case of late carrot ectasia in a patient 6 months ago, where I didn't expect it at all because the Bellin Ambrosio chart was perfect. It was the total D was 0.8. So it was really a perfect pentachem, a perfect candidate with a stable cornea, a ridiculous correction of -3 or something like that. So I didn't expect it at all. And as it always is in life, it was the son of a professor of surgery. So the bad thing about it is that it was a son of a colleague. The good thing is that the colleague did know, because I showed him the Bellin Ambrosio chart and told him that's all we could do. We didn't expect it. He knew we didn't make a mistake, but it can happen. 12 years ago, I didn't have a single case. So I if you've asked me 6 months ago, I would have said no case, I didn't have it. If you take care of the evaluation of data preoperative, you cannot have late keratectasia with SMILE. But now I have to correct myself. You can have it, and even if you don't await it. So what did we do? We did a cross-leaking afterwards. That is one thing. And the other thing is, in over 6,000 cases, I had one patient where in the Berlin Ambrosia chart, I saw there is form frisk keratoconus, and the other eye didn't have it. But the patient was so desperate, he didn't want to wear contact lenses, he couldn't wear his glasses. So we both agreed we do SMILE surgery, and if the keratectasia worsens, then we do cross-linking. But the patient knew about that in the informed consent before surgery. And when it came, we did a cross-linking. And since then, the cornea is perfectly stable. And the patient has, of course, a much better vision than before SMILE surgery, despite he had a late keratectasia. So the patient still is very happy, thinks it was the right decision. But it's very important to inform those patients before surgery that they might need cross-linking after surgery.
All right, thank you so much. The next question, dear Professor Detlef, do you have a fellowship program for cornea and refractive surgery? Thank you so much for the information.
I'm always thinking about it. But the problem is, that I'm in a, it's my private clinic. That means I have 150 employees I have to take care of. I do 30 surgical cases every day I have to take care of. I have to see 30, 40 patients a day I have to take care of. Okay. I do my science. So I never developed a fellowship program, but as many, many doctors are visiting me or writing to me, I'm thinking about developing a fellowship program. Yeah, I think it might be a good idea, but as I don't have it, you are always invited to see patients with me for a week, come to my OR to see me doing surgery. So whenever you want to come by, you're more than welcome. I'm very happy to share my knowledge.
Thank you. Do you have time, Professor?
Yeah.
One more question, I think.
No problem. Okay.
Professor, would you like to tell me about the maximum diopter of astigmatism that you could treat with a SMILE? Thank you so much, Professor.
Officially, it's up to 10. I do it up to 9 because due to my personalized nomogram, I have to target for plus 1 diopter. So plus 9 is the cutoff. I know that Osama Ibrahim in Egypt goes to higher diopters. And last time I talked to him, he said, if you respect the 250 micrometers residual stromal thickness, you can do it, or you combine it with a SMILE extra. In Germany, we are not allowed to do it. It would be against the law and the recommendations of our society. So I don't do it. In those patients, I usually use an ICL, or I inform the patient that there will be an undercorrection. But I usually prefer the ICL.
Thank you so much. Oh, I apologize. There is one more question, Professor. It's okay?
This is.
Okay. Do you have any experience about reoperation, Professor? Thank you.
I had with the old laser one circle procedure, and this turned out to be perfectly fine. Then the ICL, of course, easy procedure that can substitute and help you in those cases. And I personally never had a trans-PRK because I'm only doing trans-PRK with a Schwind Amaris 1050 RS since 3 years. And as I didn't miss a target in those 3 years, I didn't have to do a trans-PRK. But the one patient where I couldn't remove the lenticule, so it was a very complicated case, That was done with TransPRK and has a 20-20 vision right now.
All right. So marvelous. So many questions have been answered by our super maestro at this very moment. Great speaker, great audiences. So impressive. Well, here we are spreading love, care, peace, and tranquility on earth. Thank you, SMEC Group. Thank you, ID, Perdami Sumut, Anak Sudarti Foundation, Carl Zeiss. And thank you all committee, Dr. Diah in Medan and Hafiz in Jakarta. Thank you so much. And thank you so much our distinguished participant and special to our maestro, Professor Detlef Breyer. Please send our regard to your family. Thank you so much, Detlef.
Thank you.
Soon, Professor.
It was a great pleasure with you and also the very interesting questions. And again, the only thing I can tell you, I don't have a fellowship program, but I'm more than happy to share my knowledge if you want to visit me in Germany. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much. You are absolutely phenomenal, Professor. Thank you. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Professor. Thank you so much.
And I would be happy for teaching reasons if you could, if you recorded the session, if you could send it to me. That would be very kind.
All right. It's recorded in YouTube, Professor. I will send the link to you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Have a nice
evening. Okay, Professor. Bye-bye. Thank you so much. And our distinguished participants, on next December, our webinar will be the 25th Maestro Lecture. Hopefully, we will have Professor Ashraf Armian from Egypt. The link also will be sent via email. Furthermore, the certificate for this webinar will be sent hopefully before 2 weeks. Hopefully before 2 weeks. Your participation is highly appreciated. See you all. Thank you so much, our distinguished friends from all around the world. Happy National Teachers Day for my fellow teachers in Indonesia. And happy Thanksgiving to my friends from all around the world. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye-bye. Sudah tak mati ini.